Okay, welcome everyone to this meeting of the joint conceptual workshop of the Franklin Municipal Planning Commission and the Board of Mayor and Aldermen for February 23rd, 2023. We'll start with a quick call to order. Commissioner Allen's not here yet. Commissioner Franks. Commissioner Harrison, not yet. Commissioner Lindsay's here. Commissioner McLemore. Commissioner Mann.
Present.
Commissioner Orr.
Present.
Alderman Peterson.
Here.
And Commissioner Williamson. Okay.
Present.
And then Alderman Berger.
Present.
Yes. And Patrick Baggett.
Present.
Alderman Barnhill, not yet. Alderman Potts, you're here. Okay.
Yes, sir. Present.
And Alderman Blanton. And Alderman Hanson, I don't see. Alderman and Mayor Moore, present. Okay, so I mentioned first, accommodations have been made to ensure that the public is able to view this meeting. The public may view the workshop in the following ways. You can watch the meeting on Franklin TV or the City of Franklin website. You can watch the live stream of the City of Franklin through the City of Franklin web Facebook and YouTube accounts, or you can attend in person in the boardroom. The public may also watch the meeting on the TV in the lobby. So I mentioned we're jam-packed. We are. We've got five full items on the agenda today. I'll let you know early on how much. We've got 20 minutes scheduled for this first item. This is item one, presentation and discussion concerning transportation impacts and the current City of Franklin requirements. So I'll turn it over to Paul.
Okay, so I'm going to present today with Adam Mosier, your city traffic engineer, and I'll put together this presentation with me.
We're going to try to go through the presentation fairly quickly because ultimately we're looking for your feedback, your guidance on how to implement different standards. So agenda, we're going to talk a little bit about the Cool Springs transportation study. We ran two different scenarios and Adam can walk you through that. High level, just brief reminder of what different level of services are. Give you kind of an overview of our traffic impact analysis guidelines and requirements. Briefly touch on city projects and then hopefully facilitate some discussion and feedback from y'all. So I'm gonna turn it over to Adam Mosier.
Yeah, so we put this presentation together. We wanted to kind of revisit the Cool Springs transportation study just because we often get that question about, well, when you get a development in, what about traffic? What's it do to traffic? And I think there's a little bit of a maybe some confusion sometimes on what's what and what's you know, a lot of traffic and what's not a lot of traffic. So looking at the going to the Cool Springs transportation study and looking at the project limits, this was our scenario two, which shows all the approved development that we've approved in that project area. This was over a year and a half ago, maybe foggy.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Sorry. There you go. Wait for that to pop up.
Click share is not working.
And while he's doing that, I'll just remind it. So the project area was basically from Moore's Lane down to 96. Carruthers on the east side, Mallory on the west side, and they kind of looked at that whole area right there. There you go. So all the areas in red, those red areas on the map are all the approved developments that they did in the Cool Springs transportation study. They added in. On the right side is a list of them with approximate percent complete of those developments. Some of them during the study were not complete. For instance, Carruthers Crossing West and East. They weren't in there, so the actual results are more based on the development trip generation than they are real life existing traffic. So that's pretty much the study area right there. Again, not in the study is the Haven and Optima in that particular Cool Springs transportation study. This is just a reminder. What is level of service when we talk about A through F? You know, you can kind of think of like a grading system when you're in school, but we kind of put that back to what is the seconds of delay. So on that far right column over there, we have 10 to 80 or greater than 80. That's really kind of what we're talking about when we hear level of service. That's something I want you to concentrate on as we go. it is just an informational slide. Again, and when we talk about extreme traffic delay, it varies for people. Is 80 seconds your preference, you know, for delay, or hey, anything that's failed? Some people don't think so. You live in an urban area, it's a lot higher. And really in Franklin, when I'm talking about signalized delay, we typically don't run cycles over 160 seconds. So that means how long it takes to go all the way around an intersection. So that's kind of our thought, is if it takes more than two cycles to get around, to get through an intersection, most people think that's intolerable, that we get calls when that happens. So going back to the study, looking at this is all the approved development. We call that scenario two in the study. Again, we invite you to look on the website. It's on the website. I think it's in our engineering development page. But as you can see, with all 100% approved development, we do have failures. And when I went back, and one thing I want you to look at is that 160-second, kind of keep that in your mind. That's when we start getting those calls. So you can see where we're at right now in that study area. So again, that's with all the improvements that are required of the developer as well. So that might be an offset improvement, might be somewhere down the line, not just out on their site. It might be, you know, down the road a little bit. So that's with the improvements that they're required to do on all those approved developments. This scenario, we call it 25% maximized development scenario. Remember, this is the Cool Springs area, not just in the city in general. But I'm going to read you what this entails for maximized development. It's defined as potential development, redevelopment, infill opportunities of parcels in the study area. So it's a combination of the land use, the zoning, and the property assessment data for the future development opportunities. So the consultant took all these documents, looked at that, and basically said what can be infilled, redeveloped, et cetera, in that area. So what this is showing is basically the failures of those if we did 25% maximized development using those documents. And outside of the Cool Springs Transportation Study, we're going to show you a model. This is actually Goose Creek model. This is a recent model, and it's probably hard to see, but let me show right there. We have a vehicle in this particular model. This is Goose Creek in 65, and I'm kind of jumping around, but it gives you a good idea of a 160-second delay. This is actually about a 3-minute delay, 180 seconds. Where Paul is putting his pointer, that's a vehicle in the queue. Again, it's kind of hard to see those vehicles, but you can kind of see the white along Goose Creek. Those are all vehicles stacked up during this time. And there's a timer going at the bottom, and that's that vehicle that's sitting in that queue. So the vehicle's sitting there waiting to make it through the northbound ramp, go straight. The funny thing about that, right now it's green, but he can't go anywhere because the queue's stacked up across the ramp, or across the bridge. So kind of just like State Route 96, you know, we get that kind of condition a little bit in our PM peak in different times of the day. So they can't go anywhere. As you look down to the west towards the Chadwell development, and again, this is our Goose Creek study. So this is actually taking that scenario three of the Goose Creek study, which is no overpass, no interchange to the south of Goose Creek. And it's running the traffic, basically, of all the development that's been approved and maybe future development on the east side. So you can see he's still waiting. Timer's going. Southbound ramp is backed up with that traffic. Northbound ramp has some traffic on it. And the northbound ramp just got released. Slowly but surely, the queue is dissipating down towards Chadwell so that the northbound ramp can make their movement. And then we go to the eastbound left turn onto the northbound ramp. This is the PM peak model. You'll notice he's still waiting. While all this traffic is moving. So we wanted to give you a good example of And you might experience this if you travel on State Route 96. We do have a couple of videos that we were going to show, but we thought this kind of gives you a better overview, bird's eye view of those interchange and all the traffic that's moving through there.
This is based on traffic counts right now.
This is the Goose Creek Scenario 3 study. So that's with all approved development on along Goose Creek and some of the potential development on the east side on Paytonsville Road. If you remember in that particular study, it was the short-term properties next to Reams Fleming on the east side of Paytonsville Road.
But this doesn't include the improvement on the 65 South at Thompson Station?
No, that interchange, no.
Jumped on me.
I think we're all the way to just about to the end.
Could you send this to us, please?
Absolutely.
None of us have this.
Yeah, you can't really see the car is moving. The object is that car is finally moving. Now that it's been almost 3 minutes, he's finally getting across the bridge. And again, that's kind of what we, if you think about that 160, 180 seconds, 3 minutes, whatever you want to call it, this is just an example scenario of that delay, that level of service F with a 3 minute delay, 180 seconds. So we wanted to give you that scenario and an example of that.
If you go back on the scenario, how far back do you track that vehicle? As from that point, and you say it gets across the bridge, the scenario looked like it stopped before the car exited the bridge, did it?
It's for the intersection. So you start counting delay once you go under 5 miles an hour. So once you come to it's called a slowdown, a stop, that's your delay. Under 5 miles an hour, and then once he passes the intersection and goes past it and he's through the intersection, then that's the time where they stop on the delay. So he's got to be on the other side of the intersection for just that intersection.
And exceeding 5 miles an hour.
Okay.
Yeah, so the reason we showed that was just to help you understand what, at least in our mind, is extreme traffic delay as we categorize it. And in the Cool Springs area, as you saw in the 25% build-out scenario, there's a significant number, if we ever get to that build-out scenario, there's a significant amount of signals during AM, midday, PM that are going to experience that if we continue down that path of that 25% development route. So what do we do as staff? How do we try to overcome this? And what tools do we have? That's where we do a traffic impact analysis and work with the developer. We have a third-party consultant that helps to review it. And really, it's based off of trip generation if they have to do it. If they have 100 to 250 peak hour trips, they have to study a half mile radius. If they have greater than the 250 peak hour trips, they're required to evaluate a mile radius. And they essentially have to do data collection, a capacity analysis, look at internal circulation, and then recommendations to meet city standards. So what are city standards? Essentially, we want that overall level service to be a D during any peak hour. Or we want the turn lanes to at least meet that level service E during those peak hours. If they cannot do that, then we come back and say, well, we're going to require off-site improvements. We use the Cool Spring study to help guide us in what those improvements should be. But even with those improvements that we're proposing, which is essentially double left turns, right turns, triple through lanes in all directions at these intersections, even with that at the 25%, we're still seeing a significant number of intersections hit failure.
Paul, can you tell us one more time what the 25% means?
The 25% build out, that was this slide that Adam showed you. It was one of the scenarios we ran in the Cool Springs area. And what he said was we looked at 25% maximum development where you can infill, what you can do. Parking lots were to redevelop. And what it showed was, and I'm going to use the PM as an example, it's saying that 78% of our signals there will have 160-second delay, which is what that model was trying to show you, what that 160-second delay really feels like.
Yeah, the 90% is F. That was that 80-second, 78% above 160.
Right.
And when you say they're redeveloped, I'm guessing so let's say there's a parking lot today and you're assuming that's redeveloped into what is the current zoning permits and the maximum the current zoning would permit today. Is that what you, so if the maximum zoning permitted an apartment building there, an office building, nine stories tall, that's what you would that's what your model would reflect.
Right. So there has been some of those that have come in recently where they're putting, they're infilling the parking lot with some retail and office. That's correct. That's basically what it is. Or if the land, one of the things is if the building that sits on the land, if the building is worth less than what the land's worth, those were prime for redevelopment. So they took all those and said, okay, what's the document that allows, what can we put on this? And so that's 25% of the area that they've chose to look at, so to redevelop.
Okay.
So I want to touch briefly, and we have some more questions at the end that'll get to your points, is want to briefly touch on the capital investment program. Essentially, the board has looked at what is needed in a 10-year period, and then we fund what projects we can. And they'll tell you that there's many worthy projects, but limited funding. And essentially, we go through a process where we rank them based off of the city's strategic plan. And then ultimately, the board picks the projects to fund. A lot of times, they're picking projects that are, you know, going to help drive economic development or support existing businesses in the Cool Springs area or out, you know, along Carruthers Parkway, Long Lane Overpass, those type projects. So it's an important part of this. And as part of a traffic impact study, the developers allowed, if it's a funded project, to show that the city's doing that and help their level of service or their delays that they're projecting on the system. So in summary, you know, the traffic projections in the Cool Springs, Goose Creek area are, they're really showing an extreme a lot of traffic delay. And that's why we went through the Cool Springs study. That's why we're going through the Goose Creek study. And the Board of Mayor and Alderman's capital improvement plan, which they're doing a great job with, is really targeting areas where we want to support growth and see growth. And I'm gonna turn it over to Vernon to talk a little bit about the questions to bring it home.
Thank you, and good evening, Aldermen and Planning Commissioners. Last Friday, when we had our joint meeting, we talked about, towards the end of the meeting, about making sure, they're trying to do our best to make sure the Aldermen and Planning Commissioners were aligned with an envisioned Franklin. And I had mentioned that we also want to know, as we go through the updating of envisioned Franklin, what you need for staff when we make recommendations. And tonight, this begins the conversation. We don't expect to have any definite answers here, but it's what staff needs from you all so we can provide the people that are building our community, the property owners, the developers that come in, our businesses that are investing in our community, give them guidance early on. And Paul and Adam shared with you the quandary that we're facing. And I want to highlight three questions here, elaborate a little bit more, and then turn it over to you all. And the first one is, how should we handle developments that have major impacts on our transportation network? Number two, should we continue to require developers to upgrade intersections and roadways that are projected to have extreme traffic delay? And then, how do you want staff to manage growth and development density as individual projects come forward? Now, I want to share with you two recent examples just to illustrate and to help you understand the type of direction that we need. Number one, before I get into those, is that we've done a study of where we should direct growth and where we have existing infrastructure or able to upgrade infrastructure makes sense. And along the I-65 corridor is one of those areas. However, in Cool Springs, that infrastructure, as growth and redevelopment continues, needs to be upgraded, and it comes at a high cost. You saw a little bit down in Goose Creek, we're doing the Goose Creek coordinated study, and there's gonna need to be some additional infrastructure there depending on what the future vision for that area is. Several weeks back, I came to you with Adam and Paul, we talked about the Optima development on Cool Springs Boulevard and talked about what their traffic impact analysis stated about improving two intersections. One at Cool Springs Boulevard in Mallory, and the other one at McEwen in Mallory. And the board made a decision that we would look at that as part of our capital improvement project. A project that you're going to be looking at tonight that we have not evaluated the traffic impact analysis. And please understand too, we have a, besides Adam and David and our team, we also have a third party that looks at those analyses to validate the data. But we have a multifamily development that you're going to be hearing about later this evening that's on right on the east side of I-65 and Liberty Pike. And the board has already approved and prioritized and funded a roundabout at Liberty Pike and Mallory, where Royal Oaks comes and the CVS is right there in Centennial High School. A question, while we haven't seen the traffic analysis, it would seem logical that there's that intersection's already delayed. A 400 or so apartment complex is going to add to that delay at peak times. So the question that might be asked, do we wait until the roundabout construction starts in 3 or 4 years before we allow that apartment complex to go forward? Now, that's the type of direction we're eventually going to want from you, because we don't want to put you in a position after a developer spends time and money designing something that we're going to have these hard discussions. So I'm going to leave it at that. Hopefully, Paul, Adam, I did justice to the conversation, and turn it over from you for the rest of the time we have on this item.
So we had a project come before us some 6 months or so ago on Cool Springs Boulevard, and it, lo and behold, it impacted, it caused maybe a loss of a level of efficiency at Mallory and Cool Springs Boulevard, and we're all like, how can that be? It's almost a mile between those two projects. But the reality is it is. And if we're already failing at these intersections and some of our solutions are 4 years out, by the time we get 2 years and 3 years out, then we're behind by another level somewhere, maybe in the same overall network. And so, I mean, you could get to the point where the traffic issues are so intolerable and maybe that's where we're headed. So we get to the point where people start to say, well, Franklin's got such crappy traffic control, and you have to sit through traffic lights 4 and 5 times to get through. We just won't go there anymore. I don't want to see that happen. But I think too that it's over these last 6 months that we're maybe seeing for the first time the significance of how important it is that when you drop a new 4-story, 5-story apartment complex along Cool Springs Boulevard, that it's gonna destroy the traffic flow all the way to the interstate. So, go ahead.
Do we know what Brentwood has planned for the Moores Lane overpass? Any improvements scheduled for that?
I know they're looking at significant upgrades. They're still in the planning stage as far as I know. Uh-huh. And I anticipate they'll bring us into it because it does include one leg that comes into Franklin.
Right.
But I think they're still in the planning phase.
And anything we do, new development in Long Crothers, Cool Springs area, is going to hammer that already failing system as well.
Others? Commissioner Williamson?
It seems like, kind of looking at those questions, some of the biggest issues we see is just lack of funding, you know, because you have a development going. I think that one that came in and it was, you know, certain size, and all of a sudden, like, it made all these intersections fail, and it was just like that little straw that breaks the camel's back. And yeah, if they could make all the improvements and it was free, yeah, we'd love to see those improvements happening, but that's not the reality. The reality is there's a funding burden to the developer. There's a funding issue with the city, like how much is the city going to do? So I see it's not the kind of the want to improve it. It's just a big funding gap is what I see from a lot of this. And then it's just like, you know, how is that handled? And, you know, with the question of, you know, roundabout's going to be built in 5 years, and do you delay development? And I think on one point, you know, if it's funded and it's scheduled and we know that it actually will happen, I think that's probably a little different conversation than hoping that more development would provide, you know, fees or, you know, where the developer is fixing it. I think that's, those are two different conversations. I don't know. It's like, how much failure do we want to kind of put up with while it's like 5 years to get this roundabout? And I think funding is a big question on a lot of this.
If I might, well, I'll have to agree with what my thoughts, if I were dictator, Lord knows I'd love to be Dictator Franklin, but my thing would be, I think that it is our fiduciary duty, Alderman and Planning Commission, to make sure that we get it, we stay ahead of this. We already have intersections that are at F. They're already at F. And for us to continue to approve developments that are going to make it F, and I mean, I guess there are degrees of F. We go from 3-minute delays to 5-minute delays. We needn't think that we're so special that people won't stop coming if traffic gets even worse. There are places now that, you know, used to be the it cities that are no longer the it cities because of things just like this. And I remember when, you know, Cool Springs saved our behinds when the rest of the state was in financial trouble, and you were here. There's some other people that were here. When the rest of the state was going through financial problems and were having problems with cash flow, Cool Springs saved us. We needn't think that there could not be financial woes in the future. I'm not predicting that, Lord knows, I hope not. But we don't need to kill our golden, we don't need to kill a golden goose, so to speak. So I think that, I don't think we need to feel so much pressure. I mean, it's great that people want to go come here. And I love the fact that our city's grown from used to be number 12, 11 on the, when they used to, our license tags used to be numbered 1 through 95. We were 11 at one time. I think we were 11. But anyway, but I just think that it is our duty. It is our duty to make sure that we go from having all these Fs. Why would we continue to just compound that? And I just don't think we should be so excited about having so many people want to come here and allowing them that we don't take care of our infrastructure. If we can't afford to do it, we don't.
Yeah, so we're going to be real stressed to get everything done here. Mayor, have you got a short comment?
Yeah, I just got a quick comment, and that is, if I look at question number one, what's happening, or what has already happened, is we've seen projects that we could have shouldered the developer with that we've pushed onto our capital projects list, and I think that's a mistake, because that just pushes those opportunities to fix those problems down to a later date, and like Jenny said, it's a funding issue. So we need to, you know, if it is such a desirable place to build and have a development, it also should be a place where they're willing to put the money into it.
Right. Okay. Alderman Baggin.
Yeah. Quickly. I think agree. I think we need to set some better expectations on the front end, which I appreciate Vernon and you guys doing this. The desire to have this conversation earlier on with the developers I want to encourage that. So however that can happen, the expanding to a 1 mile, the traffic study requirement, definitely in the Cool Springs area. I mean, I don't know how we can't expand. Isn't that right? Right now, it's not required.
Right now, it's half mile and a mile, depending on the number of trips. It's either one.
I mean, I know that folks aren't going to like that development community, but if I know who's really not going to like all that red, the citizens who elect us.
Right.
And so, expanding that study area may help. And then that's all.
Yeah. We gave away a lot of density for no roads.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, Alderman Berger.
So one of the things is, do we not allow apartment complex to go in until the roundabout or the roads are done? That was a comment tonight. And I would say, we don't allow the apartment complex to go forward at all. These standalone apartment complexes have got to go. We have our fill of them. There are gazillions of apartment complexes in our town around the interstate where they belong, granted, but this is adding to this backlog and this traffic all day long. I'm not opposed to apartments. I'm not opposed to rentals, but they really should go from now on in our town, not in standalone
massive apartment buildings, but they should go into the major mixed-use developments.
Yeah.
Where they're incorporated within that development. They're not standalone monstrosities anymore. We have too many of those. And the biggest eyesore, the biggest problem we have is around Carruthers right now, across from Lifetime, with those four or five apartment buildings. So going backwards is not a good idea. I think the roundabout, when we get that going, that's going to move traffic, because the more lights we put up, the more traffic is stopped. The more roundabouts you have, and if you do them right, which we will do them right from now on, allows for that flow. So I would also say, how much density, just because we have density over there, how much density is too much?
Yeah.
We continue to pour density into density all day long? I don't think so.
Right. Commissioner Craigs, you're good? Okay. So we're 10 minutes past. Alderman Potts, very quickly.
Mr. Chair, recognizing your comment about being 10 minutes past. Vernon, thank you for the point about Royal Oaks at Centennial Roundabout by the CVS. I think that we do need to have the difficult conversations now. And I know that we have started those conversations. They need to continue. Yes, on number two. And as far as managing expectations, this has got to be done now so that we can move this forward.
Right.
Thank you, sir.
And then the last thing, I think,
I think we need to look at the roundabout. I personally am not sure that that is the best way to handle that.
And Roger, I would echo that I think it's not a good practice for our board to continually go back and change what we're doing, what we've proved in the past.
Okay. I'm going to move on because I know of time. What I'd like to say is, and Eric reminded me, we'll bring this to the Board of Mayor and Aldermen at a work session too, because we only have a separate here.
Would y'all please email us that list of those questions?
Absolutely.
So that we'll all have those and we can respond. Okay, thanks so much, everybody. It's just, we could sit here and talk about this for an hour, for 2 hours. Okay, item number two tonight, discussion of a development plan revision proposing a 5,000 square foot addition and additional permitted uses for the Vintage at Watson Glen PUD subdivision on 21.24 total acres, located near the intersection of South Royal Oaks Boulevard and Oak Meadow Drive. The Vintage at Watson Glen PUD revision number one. So,
thank you. The PUD revision's proposed additional uses are supported by Envision Franklin. The plan also proposes an additional 5,000 square feet of office, and while staff is not overly concerned with the use, a parking analysis that addresses how the added square footage will be parked has not been provided. Staff requested that this analysis be submitted at initial submittal during the pre-application meeting. In addition, an update to the original traffic impact analysis has not been submitted, and the TIA must be reviewed and approved by the city and the third-party consultant prior to the plan moving forward to FMPC and BOMA. Staff and the applicant would appreciate any feedback or guidance you'd like to provide. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So, Greg.
Hi, my name is Greg Campbell. I'm representing the applicant, the owners of Vintage at Watson Glen. Unfortunately, they're under the weather tonight, so I told them to stay at home. But I'm happy to walk you through our proposal, if you wouldn't mind going to the next slide there. We're not proposing a change to the development plan physically, with the exception of the building that's at the hard corner of Royal Oaks and Oak Meadow. We're proposing an addition of 5,000 square feet as a second floor that would be an office use on top of the restaurant. There's an image that's being handed out 11 by 17. I want to caveat, staff has not reviewed this yet. This is more or less hot off the press. But I wanted your feedback and input on what you think about this particular building and the architectural style. The building is designed under the commercial mixed-use building form and is required to have flat roofs. It is a two-story building. You can see the restaurant on the ground floor with the outdoor dining out in front on the hard corner. And then the second floor office space that would be above that. You also can see the quick serve restaurant that's located off the intersection, just to the back. The So that's the request that we're making. Over the past two to two and a half years, my client has been approached by several different businesses, such as medical clinics, rehabilitation centers, daycares, garden centers, gas station, indoor animal services and pet salon, personal services, retail, and they have not been able to consider those uses as a part of this corner because they're not approved uses today. What we are asking for is that some additional uses be added to the PUD in the event that this restaurant concept does not move forward. There have been very good ongoing negotiations with the local restaurateur about building these restaurants out, and they'd like to put their family office on the second floor, so it becomes a place where they work and operate out of. However, in the event that those don't move forward, my client would like to have some alternative uses included in the PUD that would be approved by the board, mayor, and aldermen. In the event that there is a change to the plan, in other words, the square footage is not increased, but maybe the building's oriented a little bit differently, the plan would have to go back to the Planning Commission. That would be a trigger requirement, that it would have to go back to the Planning Commission. We would have to alert the neighbors that there's a new plan for the property. As I stand before you today, though, what you're seeing in front of you is what's being proposed, the restaurants with the office. They have been searching for this opportunity for the past two and a half years, but in the event this doesn't move forward, they want a backup plan, I guess you could say, a plan B. And that would be including a couple of uses in the PUD that would be required to come back to the Planning Commission if the site plan were to change. So I've given you the use regulations that are right out of the zoning ordinance. Highlighted in the vertical column is the PD district. So these are all the uses with the black dots that are permitted in the PD district. We're not asking for all of them to be included, only the ones that have the green line going across there. So I hope that's clear and understandable, but happy to hear any comments or questions that you may have. And I understand staff's request for an updated traffic study as well as the shared parking agreement. Those are all in process and should be completed in the near few days.
Okay. Yes.
So are you planning on building a restaurant?
Yes.
And because that's what we've heard all along.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. And so what's your problem?
In the event that the restaurant doesn't work out, they've tried for 2 to 2.5 years to get a restaurant in there. This opportunity came forward, and the request from the restaurateur is to add an additional 5,000 square feet for an office on the second floor.
Okay.
If that doesn't move forward, they're asking for some additional uses be included in the PUD. If those additional uses, because they haven't been able to even discuss with these other businesses this opportunity, because we've been solely focused on restaurants. But if that doesn't move forward, because there's some questions about the access. We have a right-in, right-out only off of Royal Oaks, and on Oak Meadow, the access actually comes in directly across from Summerby, so it's a little bit complicated to get to. There have been some questions about whether or not this site can really accommodate a restaurant. We think this concept that we have before you tonight is a home run, and we hope that this moves forward. They can't close the contract deal because the 5,000 square feet is not currently a part of the PUD, so they can't move forward until the PUD moves forward, and that's what we're trying to do now. But in the event that it doesn't work out, they would like the opportunity to entertain medical clinic or the gas station use or garden center or retail.
That's for the corner what's labeled restaurant office.
Yes, that's correct.
Mm-hmm. The quick service is that.
We tried to pick uses that were very complementary with the corridor already, uses that are really kind of within that in the corridor today.
So I could not be supportive of a gas station there. There's one across the street, there's 100 up on Murfreesboro Road. The traffic pattern for a gas station is, I think, is different.
Well, that's the kind of input we're looking for tonight.
The rest of these uses I think would be compatible with, you know, what's already being constructed in a restaurant and or office, but a gas station, I just don't see the need for one there.
I'll add garden center to that.
Yeah, me too. Okay.
Commissioner Allen.
I was just going to say, I knew exactly what man, Commissioner Mann.
Yeah, they're just looking for some backup options that you would feel comfortable going back to the Planning Commission in the event the restaurant doesn't move forward.
Right.
The rehabilitation center, is that, not as familiar with our, the definition of that.
We have a Vanderbilt Bone and Joint Clinic just down the street that offers rehabilitation.
Got it.
And Summerbee's across the street, which has a assisted living, an independent living, and a memory care is right across the street.
It looks good, girl.
Yeah, it seemed like good uses.
Yeah.
But if you could get the retail approved above the restaurant, that's a better.
The office above the restaurant, that's what we're looking to do.
Above the restaurant, then these other uses won't even matter if you can get this approved, is what you're saying.
Well, they still need to go to contract and make sure that they can afford to buy it and build the buildings and all of that stuff. So there's a lot of due diligence left to be done.
Yeah, I would say that a lot of these uses make sense, but yeah, like especially gas station, I could not, that would probably be a lead balloon in a lot of places. And also just, other thing I'd say is, it sounds like there's some access concerns with volume and just being cognizant of that, that if one of these uses does come in and seems like it might be not favorable to access, to consider that closely before it's proposed.
Yeah. Alderman Fox.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. First, thank you for coming forward and sharing this information. And number one, it's always good to have the documents where we can hold them right here. I agree with what I'm hearing so far as gas station. I was handed before this meeting, and I want to acknowledge in the audience, we have Rich Buckner, who's the president of the Franklin Alliance of Homeowners Associations for Ward 3. And we also have representatives from Creekside Homeowners Association as well. And they provided me with some information here. I'm not going to run through all of it, but as we took a look at it, they did, within this group, there are approximately 19 HOAs that are there, and they have concern about the land use, and it aligns with what many people have shared tonight, and that is specific to the gas station. That is of concern. Garden Center was new, but thank you for sharing that one as well. The group itself, the Franklin Alliance of Homeowner Associations for Ward 3, has very little, I guess, argument with allowing the second floor, the 5,000 square feet that's being proposed. I think that actually, the second floor restaurant office by this family-owned and operated business. So they feel like that is in alignment with things. And based off of the additional input that I've received, as it's being presented and by removing, it sounds like the board is, or this group is recommending removing gas stations and possibly garden centers, that would meet the concerns that have been raised tonight.
Thank you. Alderman Berger.
Yeah, real quick. So I would love to see you get a restaurant in here, maybe a clinic or something like that. I'm with you all about the gas station, all that stuff. But this corner is extremely important. It's a transition as you go down Royal Oaks, because once you leave that area on Oak Meadow, it has a different feel going forward. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's really important how this is not a gateway, but it's, you know, it opens it up. And it's important how this is positioned. I love the way you position this design. It's all about design in my book. Mm-hmm. And the thing is, the design is attractive. It showcases the corner, and it gradually pulls you into the site, and then you've got housing around it and everything else. So it's really extremely important what goes here and the design.
Good. Mayor.
Yeah, I kind of like what I'm seeing here on the corner. If it were a restaurant and the office, I'm a little anxious, having been sensitized with some recent emails about approving a whole bunch of other uses. So I wouldn't be supportive of that at this point. Is this just what they want to do? Let them do it, but not a bunch of changes.
Okay.
You need a restaurant.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Alderman Potts.
Thank you, and I apologize for not including this on the previous remarks. And I and I apologize, I don't know if this is tied specifically into this piece or a previous agreement, but want to make sure that we have the proper park that's already been previously agreed to.
Yes.
That's being put in place and how that's going to accent that area as well. And also preserve a lot of the trees and a lot of the need that's there.
Absolutely, yeah. It's a part of the construction plans now, and that's not changing, for sure.
Right, and to that point, there's an awful lot of water features, if you will, mm-hmm. in this area. And so riparian zones, 30-foot, zone one, zone two, all of which needs to be preserved, not replanted after it's destroyed, but preserved before we go in. Okay. So one last comment.
Quick comment. I would say for architecture, just be cognizant it is a corner for floor-to-floor height, especially that restaurant in this image. It looks like that's quite high. So I would say be cognizant of the surrounding buildings so that this corner doesn't get too tall.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, good point.
Well, thank you. That was the input we're looking for. We appreciate it.
Okay, thank you, Greg. Item number three, discussion of a development plan proposing 9,500 square feet of commercial space and 375 multifamily units on 4.66 acres located at 1312 Huffines Ridge Drive. The project is referred to as 1312 Huffines Ridge PUD. We've got 30 minutes scheduled for this item, so keep that in mind as we go forward. Staff presentation. Chelsea.
Thank you. This PUD has many components that are supported by Envision Franklin. It has a mix of uses activating the street. Its height is within the suggested height limits for the interstate corridor, and it has compatible architecture. With that being said, the plan also leaves several questions unanswered with staff's first two rounds of reviews. I'll highlight four. You can refer to the screens. I kind of have these bulleted. The traffic impact analysis has been submitted, but it is still being reviewed by the city and the third-party consultant. Number two is that the parkland agreement has not yet been submitted to staff, and to avoid delays, this must be submitted to staff on the resubmittal date or risk the development plan being delayed, waiting for it to catch up with the public hearings for the parkland agreement. Number three, the full scope of the design has not yet been submitted. The plan does not yet show how the parking garage entry points align with the road network across the street to see if any turning conflicts exist. It also does not show the full length of the building, so staff cannot analyze how the open space plays a part in the streetscape or what the proposed sky bridge looks like. Fourth is that the fire accessibility cannot be fully supported yet with the information provided. Fire has questions regarding paving materials and the hose pole length for reaching all points of the building. Beyond these four points, there are two components of the plan that will likely change between now and the public hearing. The drive aisle in front of the building will be required to have gates on it. It does not meet spacing standards for public access. The second one is that the northern building will be required to activate their ground level to meet the building type requirements. Lastly, the applicant is requesting one modification of standard for connectivity. The request is to waive the requirement for cross access to the northern property and instead provide only emergency access. Staff does not support this request. The northern property is at the end of the cul-de-sac with limited options to traverse the area. Cross access provides increased circulation for future uses of the northern property and can be accomplished on the site under consideration without disrupting its proposed circulation patterns. Staff and the applicant would appreciate any feedback you have on the MOS request specifically and then any other guidance you'd like to provide. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Chelsea. Okay, the applicant.
Hi, my name is Jeff Rosiak. I'm with Gamble Design Collaborative. Thank you so much. Thank you all for your time tonight. This project is located at... No. I can't handle my whole thing. This project is located at the northwest corner of Liberty Pike and Huffines Ridge Drive, immediately adjacent to I-65, just to the west of the site. This property is in the Regional Commerce Design Concept in Envision Franklin and is zoned RC-12, which permits up to 12 stories. So this property is obviously, as we've heard tonight, part of the larger context of the Cool Springs area, the I-65 corridor, and this corridor has seen a tremendous amount of investment in the recent years. We've highlighted a few adjacent or nearby projects: McEwen Town Center, Mars Office Campus, Franklin Park, Columbia State University. The corridor from 96 to the south all the way north to Moore's Lane has been studied for continuous transit, and transit opportunities are one way that some of the delays that we're seeing in traffic can be addressed. The Franklin Transit Authority in those studies has concluded that more residential would actually support a transit loop, a continuous transit loop, that would provide an alternate to the cars that are on the road. So this is an infill opportunity that provides that opportunity. This specific site, if you'll go, yeah, you're on the next one. All around it has seen additional investment as well. So this is next to Liberty Station, which is the mixed use property at the southeast corner of Liberty Pike and Carruthers. Carruthers Crossing West, Carruthers Crossing East, Lifetime, which is Lifetime Fitness, Mosby, Columbia State University. So all of these projects have developed around it, including also Orium, which is in planning, and Legacy Cool Springs, which is under construction. So this project is kind of one of the missing pieces in an almost complete puzzle. This site can also be a part of Greenways and Trails networks through this area, again offering a multimodal opportunity for maybe some of the folks to get around the area. We've proposed a trail that utilizes our emergency access through the site that connects up I-65 corridor, up along I-65, and connects to the old roadbed heading north across McEwen, connects all the way up to Crescent Office Center, and creates a 3.5 mile loop that loops back toward the project, toward the site. So we're proponents of the right kind of development in the right locations, and you all have seen some of this data before. This is updated to 2019 data, which is the most recent data that's available, but we have, as of that time, 81,000 jobs in Franklin. 11,000 of those 81,000 jobs are people that live and work in Franklin. 70,000 of those jobs are people who commute to Franklin. We know that a large percentage of those 70,000 jobs that people are commuting to, those cars that are on the road, would rather work in Franklin, would rather live in Franklin where they work. And many simply can't. The more residential opportunities for people to afford and establish in Franklin provide alternates to getting on the street and driving. So multifamily residential is one type of housing that allows a broader cross-section to have their housing in this this employment center in Cool Springs. Yeah. The 1312 Huffines Development Plan seeks a development plan and rezoning to allow for the construction of a mixed-use development that includes commercial, co-working, and residential uses served by wrapped parking internal to the site parking structure. The plan proposes 9,500 square feet of commercial and co-working spaces along Liberty Pike corridor at the corner of Huffines Ridge Drive. The plan also proposes 375 residential units in a stepped six-story building that includes two rooftop courtyards, an at-grade open space beneath an amenity bridge, which connects the south building and the north building, and then at-grade dog park and at-grade courtyard at the north building. As I mentioned, the plan contemplates a trail that utilizes the emergency and fire access around the site to create a trail that connects beyond to the north to still undeveloped properties. In this section elevation, you can see how the proposed building steps with the grade. The Liberty Pike frontage is about 25 feet at existing grade, lower than the north end of the site, Liberty Pike being on the left side of the page. You can see that those non-residential uses are concentrated on the Liberty Pike frontage, and that's where the commercial and co-working space is on the first level of that frontage. As you go north, you can see the rooftop amenities above the parking structure, and then again, the residential built above the parking structure. And then you can see the amenity bridge, which crosses over an area that is amenitized, has some of our stormwater management and bio areas, but also is a small park for the residents. And then as you continue north, you can see that it kind of steps to five level construction along the northern property line, where the grade is the highest. If you'll go to the next. So as I mentioned, this is RC 12, so we're proposing six-story construction, much lower than the 12 stories that's currently permitted in the zoning code. So these graphics kind of further illustrate the commercial and non-residential uses along Liberty Pike and Huffines Ridge. You can see live-work units, retail, co-working office spaces on the first and the mezzanine level. And then in that kind of exploded axon on the right side of the page, you can see the way the levels stack above that. We've also been working to develop the architectural character of the site. And so here you can see some precedent and character images from both local and regional projects that kind of flavor the architectural theming of the building. If we keep going, you can go one more. These are the elevations from Huffines that have been developed, and we're hoping to meet with staff to talk through some of the concerns that they have about architecture. This actually is a complete elevation along Huffines between this and the next graphic. So you can see where the amenity bridge connects. So this is the north building from Huffines, and the previous image was the south building from Huffines. And we'll try to clarify that in the next round of submittals so it's more clear that we're looking at that entire profile. In the next image, you'll see a streetscape from the corner of Huffines Ridge and Liberty Pike. And as Chelsea mentioned, I think there was some confusion even in this graphic about access to the front of the building. This is intended to be a, I don't know if this will work or not. This is intended to be a pedestrian plaza space. And we've actually shown a car through there. This will all be closed and is for emergency access only. So we don't intend to have two intersections that close to each other. It's just emergency access to the front of the building. That is a pedestrian plaza space. And then this final image is kind of a bird's eye view from the intersection, roughly the intersection of Carruthers Parkway and Liberty Pike. And you can see some of the buildings that are in construction and approved. This is the Harper. This is Legacy Cool Springs, which is under construction. The Harper, of course, is basically complete, and some of the approved development along the Carruthers corridor. And then back here, you can see where our site fits in adjacent to I-65. And so again, we feel like this is a project that fits in with the context of what's been approved and what's under construction around it, and is continuing the development pattern that's been established all around it. We have a few members of our team here today. We have members from architecture, Smith G Studios, from our civil engineer, Kimley Horn, and several of the ownership. So we're here to answer questions if we can.
Okay. So I have a quick question. Put that last slide back up on the screens. So one of the things that I don't have a full grasp of is you threw out some numbers when we started this. 81,000 people work here. 11,000 live here, so there are 70,000 people that have to come in from somewhere else, and yet this picture shows thousands of apartments under construction already. And so what does that do to the overall numbers? And I'm not asking, that's a rhetorical question, because there are other similar large apartment complexes under construction right now.
Sure.
And so what I'm doing is, in my tiny mind, I'm scratching for the reason that this new Huffines Ridge is going to knock some significant chunk of people off that list of that 77,000 that are still looking for a place to live while they work here. So that's, it goes to the whole concept of, you know, how many new apartments are necessary, indeed truly necessary, for the people either that are working here and looking to move here or whatever. So that's a concern. The other concern that I have is goes to the whole issue we've already talked about tonight, the traffic issue and the roundabout, and because this, again, this picture kind of raises that question in my mind. If we've already got this many large new complexes under construction, you know, what does that do to the overall traffic picture in this whole area? So that's all I've got. Commissioners, aldermen, questions?
Man, you go first.
I'm on page, the one with the concept site plan, and I'm just trying to understand the connectivity here. It looks like if you're on Liberty Pike going west, you would turn right on Huffington Ridge Drive, and then you would turn left to enter the south building. But is there any connectivity to the east, to the existing, to the Harpeth? Because it seems like this would be an ideal opportunity to connect to not only the Harpeth, but to the retail there, you know, like the Chipotle and the other retail establishments going in there. And I'm not seeing any walkability, or I don't know the drivability would even be appropriate. But
well, there is a property between ours and the Harper, and that's, as of now, undeveloped. We are providing pedestrian connections to Huffines, and obviously we've talked about some of the trail connections and creating a loop that encircles all of these sites. You're right, the vehicular access to the parking garages are here and here. That does align with the entrance to the parking garage to Legacy Cool Springs as well. So we have contemplated, you know, providing pedestrian connections. There was an old right-of-way along this kind of property line that I think the city of Franklin may have abandoned, that is now part of this property here, I think. But you know, there could be opportunities as that develops to kind of make those connections. Just north of what you can see in at Legacy Cool Springs is Easdale Drive. Easdale Drive makes a connection from Huffines to Orium. And then, Chelsea, I think it might be the slide before this. Keep going. One more. And this shows some of the future connectivity. Of course, we don't know what the plan for this site looks like just now yet, but every plan that we've seen before has shown a connection through through here from Huffines to what eventually kind of connects across to Ovation. So there is a lot of interconnectivity that happens in this little kind of block between McEwen, Liberty, Crothers Parkway.
So I think vehicular connectivity looks probably about right. I think pedestrian connectivity, I think we should, I would ask you, try to, I know the property is undeveloped in the middle, but it seems like where the current proposed greenway would be might not be the logical connection point for when that is developed. So maybe some thought there. I'm talking about the greenway in between the north and south building. And then I was hoping you could go into the modification standard request again. I'm not sure that was addressed.
That's where I'm coming in here. Is that
sure.
I already know that I wouldn't be able to support, because one of the first things out of staff's mouths was that you guys are not, and I want to know, I guess my thing is no northern connectivity, which for me, especially since the northern piece of property has not been developed, and you're going to get pushback from public safety, is why no northern connectivity.
So we've always shown an emergency access connection from this at this corner at the kind of western side of the property near I-65. We're working with staff to try and eliminate that modification of standard and provide a better connection kind of closer to Huffines. So we're hoping to eliminate that modification of standards request.
Because if we're talking about 375 multifamily units and 9,500 square feet of commercial space, because there's no way I would ever support that modification of standards. I just want to put that out there before you spend your money. But anyway, that was a major thing that really...
Sure.
Yeah, okay.
Mayor Moore, you have a...
I don't think I have anything else to add. I think everything I was going to say has been covered.
Okay. Alderman Berger.
Thanks. So how much apartment density is enough? I'm going to go back to that again. And number two, have we sampled all the people who work here who don't live here? Do we know that they actually, the vast majority of them want to live here? I would say that that's an opinion. And even half of them prefer to live here? I don't know. But if they want to, there are apartments here. And I'm looking at this saying, people can be housed in the apartments in the new mixed use. We've got Northside McEwen, we've got Ovation coming, we've got Eastworks coming. All types of apartments will be in those mixed use and will be assimilated into those mixed use. Then let me just say real quickly, we have 5,000 apartments in the pipeline that have been approved and not built yet. 5,000. And in this area, in a reasonably area of a reasonably distance of this area, we have Artesa, which is a little further over. But we have the Everly, we have the Legacy, we have the Harper, we have Dwell, we have Windchase, which is a little further down. We have IMI Cool Springs, we have McEwen Northside. We have MAA Cool Springs, Vera Cool Springs, Cadence, and Paxton, all in this area. Guys, when are we going to get, do we have to hit our heads on the wall to say, wait a minute, how much density of apartments are we going to do? I'm sorry that I have to speak against this. You know, I know people come in here and they want to do good work and they want to take a piece of property and develop it, but I'm done. I've been done for a while, and I've told you all I'm done, and I need people to get on the bandwagon. We need to start figuring this out. We talk about traffic all day. Well, you know, yeah, coming out on Liberty Pike there is tricky. It's not the most ideal thing. And, you know, I'm sorry. I don't mean to dump on the applicants and people like that, but it is, we have got to start leading in this area, and I'm just done with it. I will not support this.
Alderman Baggett.
So the pink road, those are roads, the pink. So it's going to go Legacy. Is it going on my computer here? You can go Huffines to Legacy, through the Legacy Cool Springs. There'll be a road there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then when REM is done, that will connect to McEwen.
Mm-hmm.
How far away is that connectivity?
Less than a mile.
No, I mean like time frame.
Oh, well.
Do we know?
I may be able to help.
Yeah. Staff is.
It's at phase four of the RM development.
Phase four?
That will be connecting, so it's quite a ways off. We've talked to Ralph Knauss and the South Star team if there's a way for that to move up sooner, because it would help distribute traffic a little bit better. But currently the development plan calls out at phase four.
To me, that connection is pretty critical for this whole sliver of land. And I think that's because it's going to relieve the roundabout. I think that road connection is pretty critical for anything really in this sliver of land. Because if I'm living there, I'm not going to go through Centennial traffic, roundabout, Whole Foods, take a right. I'm going that road, and so I think that's really important. Y'all can work on the timeline of that. The other thing is architectural style, and I would agree with staff. I mean, if we're gonna have them, I need to look good, and we've got a lot of really ugly apartment complexes that probably look good in these conceptual drawings or pictures, but then they end up looking like, you know, not very good. So I would consider that. You know, this could be 12 stories tall. It's outzoned, so this is shorter than that. But I agree with Alderman Berger in that. You know, I think the general consensus of the group has been, mm-hmm. let's just take a breath and see. I'm not meaning stop. I'm just saying, like, let's get our hands around what we've got and what's coming, and then before we start, because this isn't it. I mean, we start doing 300 a pop, 400. You know, this it's gonna. You know, it just yeah. the ball doesn't stop rolling. This property will be developed. That road's pretty central.
Other comments?
Well, real quick, and I think, because we do want to, the purpose of this meeting is to let developers right. know what we're thinking. Well, pretty much, I think we've already said it. But I, you know, it may be a great development, but I won't at this time. The time is off for me as far as traffic and all that. I just wouldn't. Yeah. I'm just letting you know. Because we're supposed to give them, you guys, our thoughts. Those are my true thoughts.
Yeah. Thank you.
So, and along with what Commissioner Allen was just saying, just providing my thoughts, I do appreciate the fact that you could put in a 12-story structure right here, and you're not. Mm-hmm. And it is a tiered area, or the topography of it does change, and that is concerning, especially with Centennial High School on the other side. Mm-hmm. I do get concerned with what's currently under construction and what's been approved. Regarding what Alderman Baggett was saying as far as the connectivity goes. I'm already, and staff had mentioned that we're, I think it was 4 years out before we did that roundabout right now. I think we have to reevaluate our infrastructure as we're looking at these proposals that you're bringing forward. I'll stop there in the intro.
Okay, great. All right, thank you very much.
Thanks.
Our next item number four, discussion of Envision Franklin Land Use Plan Amendment, proposing a special consideration within the multifamily residential design concept relating to increased building height, reduced parking, and the addition of retail use for the property located at 209 Old Liberty Pike, directly across from the factory at Franklin. And we've got 30 minutes scheduled for this item. So, staff presentation.
Thank you very much.
Hello.
Quick comments from staff. Staff is supportive of this amendment in general, but we are specifically seeking feedback regarding the open-endedness of the language for the height allowance, which we can see on the board right now. It's the first bullet point. As well as the necessity of the parking reduction stipulation, which you can see also right now in the second point. Staff would be more comfortable with language added that would stipulate the additional height be similar and compatible with adjacent multifamily and transitioning down in height and density towards the existing Truitt house. Right now, it is a little bit, again, open-ended, and we would just like some feedback on whether or not some more specific language would be in there. as well as for the second portion of the request regarding the parking reduction. Staff feels it's unneeded. Envision Franklin does not list parking allowances or requirements. It only specifically lists appropriate locations on a site, so staff just feels that this portion is unnecessary and could be handled as an MOS if the development plan can't meet the parking requirements of the zoning ordinance. So staff is specifically looking for feedback regarding those, but the applicant is here and has a few slides to present for you. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Okay, applicant. Gary.
Hello. Good evening. My name is Gary Vogan with Kaiser Vogan Designs, landscape architect, speaking on behalf of our client, Trulin Development Partners. Thank you for your time. As Eric mentioned, first off, we're more than happy to work with staff on these conditions that we talked about. We just tried to keep the language very similar to our Envision Franklin. So these are just language we pulled from the document, but I think what you stated seems pretty logical. But again, we are just here basically to ask for an Envision Franklin plan amendment. Special consideration for this specific parcel of property. So this first slide, keep that up, Eric. So as we know, we're talking about the Middle Eight project on Liberty Pike. It's about 7 acres in size. You can see on this site that it's adjacent to the factory along Liberty Pike, Franklin Road to the foreground, the Truett home on Franklin Road. We specifically carved out the Truett house from the parcel to maintain that frontage and presence along Franklin Road, detach it from the future land use plan amendment and the PD. So this slide just shows the overall encompassing project. So our specific request is this site is specifically zoned multifamily residential concept in Envision Franklin. We're just asking for a special consideration to allow additional height may be considered when underground parking is provided. Parking reductions may also be considered when underground parking is provided. Limited retail is appropriate to satisfy the region, the neighborhood, and the community. This is kind of one of steps that we need to go before we go to PD development plan. So the first step was historic zoning, which we went through that process, DRC, 3 times historic zoning, got approval there. Next is this land use plan amendment. If this moves forward, they could go to a PD development plan rezoning. So one of many steps. Next slide, Eric. Thank you. The district sparked by the aldermen, Alderman Baggett and Brown. Brought this to you back in December at this same venue. We saw the excitement about this at the recent workshop at the factory. So we are just bringing this Middle Eight project to this district and want to be part of this walkable community and just the stars aligning with the streetscape improvements, Harlesdale Farm, the factory, all that. So next slide, thank you. As I mentioned, we are currently concept multifamily residential within Envision Franklin. Specifically asking to keep that same designation, just ask for the special consideration for height with certain conditions. Next slide. These are some shared goals that our client has committed to. I'll just briefly go through these. Protect the value of Franklin's unique charm. Provide density for preservation by allowing new housing where infrastructure already exists. Meet the extraordinary housing demands that we all see. Provide diversity of housing and support the factory district. Next slide. As part of our submittal, we have to justify and describe what our rationale is for this land use plan amendment change. I just highlighted 4 items on this slide, but we have a very extensive submittal that talks a lot about these 4 highlights, but it's basically the factory changing, the district, the energy, the buzz, what's happening to that area. The completion of Franklin Road streetscape, improvements to Harlesdale Farm, rapid population growth. We've all seen the numbers, people coming into the town. We want to provide that opportunity for diverse housing within the downtown core. Continuous job growth. We've seen the growth. A lot of corporate headquarters relocating. So things that have changed since Envision Franklin has been amended. Next slide, Eric. So simply, we'd like to slide this special consideration. This is the Envision Franklin document, page 67, which talks about multifamily residential. There's other special considerations within this district and others, like the Hillsborough Road District, other districts that allow different uses. So we'd like to slide this piece right in there for this site specific, south of Liberty Pike, Daniels Drive, Truett House, Old Liberty Pike. and ask for this additional height with these stipulations, providing parking underground, which really changes the dynamic of this project, doing that in particular, parking underground. Next slide. So the master plan. Presented this to historic zoning. This plan basically shows three multifamily buildings in the central core along Liberty Pike, surrounded by a new street, public street, with parallel parking, on-street parking, and then a wrap, so to speak, around the road, transitioning from Liberty Pike multifamily to residential duplexes, single-family houses, townhomes, to Old Liberty Pike and the Truett House. What's unique about this graphic, what I'd like to talk about, the site plan, with the parking below, and I'll talk to you a second about that. This allows us to do very vast amounts of open space, courtyards, plazas, gathering spaces, walkability, pocket parks. We are looking at a number in terms of just pure green space of about 46.5%, 47% with all the parking underground, which is city requirements, 5% minimum formal open space. We by far surpass that. So that's why we asked for that reduction in parking also. And on this plan specifically, as you all know, Envision Franklin states within Mack Hatcher, the maximum building height is 3 stories. That's why we're asking for this land use plan amendment to go specifically for this one building adjacent Daniels Drive to be 4 stories plus 1. Jameson is in the HPO, but is a non-conforming building at 3 stories plus 1. So it already breaks that max 3 stories. We just want to be, as Eric said, compatible to Jameson Station. Next slide. This showcases how the parking works underground. A lot of detail here, but it's basically 2 levels of parking below grade that is underneath the building. The slope slides, the site slopes about 20 some feet from Liberty Pike to Old Liberty Pike. So the grade takes advantage that we can use the parking to come around the new street to park under the building to meet the requirements for the multifamily. All the on-street parking parallel spaces are for the guests or the units that kind of wrap that road, the single family, the towns, the duplexes. But you all enter the parking from the back of the building on that new street with a pedestrian lobby, gated, very secured environment. Next slide. This slide we showed at historic zoning also, but this really tells the story of what we're trying to do. Again, it's all about the transition from Franklin Road to Daniels Drive and Jameson Station and the factory. On this slide, the elevation to the top on my right-hand side is Franklin Road. The Truett House is 2 stories. We have a 75-foot buffer behind the Truett House, which is required by historic zoning. So there's 75 feet of naturalistic vegetated screening. The first bank of townhomes are 2 stories, right there where his cursor is. 2-story townhomes facing Liberty Pike. Our new street, which goes into the development. Then we have a 3-story, which is a 2+1 recessed, which is 3 stories, which meets Envision Franklin. The next one is a 4-story plus 5th-story recessed. Again, building to the character of Jameson Station, being within 10% of that height. On this document, it says 30 inches, but we want to be within 10% of that height per the historic zoning guidelines. So we are specifically talking about this building, this eastern building against Daniels Drive for this land use plan amendment to allow us additional height for the additional parking underground and open space provided. The diagram below really speaks to the elevations can't show how the building really reacts to the street. So we're showing several courtyards, ebbs and flows of the building to provide open space, courtyards, walkability, pedestrian experience, units facing courtyards. Jameson Station is right on the curb, 14 feet off from the columns, about 20 feet from the back of curb to the main facade. We vary from 25 to 30 to 77 feet on some of these courtyards just to create interest in the building, and it's not right up on the street. So important element there. But all the units face the street. You have porches, stoops, activation on the street. Next slide, please. Wanted to show also historic zoning requested this image before and after. Lower image is existing, factory on the left. We are standing about 100 feet off of Franklin Road.
looking towards Jamison Station, which is the terminus of this street on Liberty Pike. Right down the middle there. Thanks, Eric. The middle eight, which is off to the right, that first bank of townhomes I talked about is about 338 feet off of Franklin Road. So a good distance. You've got the Truett House, the buffer, the townhomes there. So just want to show the before and after of that, just showing the transition from two stories up to Jamison. Also, historic zoning said, well, what does it look like from Liberty Pike the other way? So we showed from the railroad tracks, Jamison Station on your left, factory on your right, and how we can animate the street. Kind of where that car is on the left-hand side, Eric, right down. That guy right there is about where Daniel Drive is. So that's the break of the middle eight from Jamison Station. So again, Jamison Station, four stories. We're requesting 4+1 on this one building on Daniels. Excellent. Just want to articulate some of the building massing and location. This is on Liberty Pike. This is the main courtyard between the east and west multifamily buildings. Again, just activation of the street. Potential maybe outdoor cafe, outdoor seating, walkability to the city of Franklin and Franklin Factory. But just shows a 4+1 on the left-hand side with a recessed penthouse suite above. Those recesses are typically about 18 to 20 feet back from that top level. And then the building on the right is the two stories plus one recessed. Next slide, please. This shows our furthest building along Daniels Drive. Jamison Station is on the left. And just want to show that we'd like to, again, animate the street, activation of the courtyard units, and show what this building potentially could look like. Again, every building on Liberty Pike and along Daniels has to go historic zoning, so they will get their teeth into every detail that we need to show for these buildings, so very crucial. Next slide, please. Because we have so much parking underground, offers the opportunity to do a lot of open space. This is one little pocket park along the new street, backing up to the Truett House and Franklin Road and along Old Liberty Pike, just a little English garden. These are just kind of nestled between two of the residential units with the multifamily in the background. Next slide. This is our little pocket park on the south side that houses detention, water quality, little dog park, walking trails that eventually connect you to Old Liberty Pike, to the Old Liberty Park on Old Liberty Pike. It's hard to say. But a nod to history for the Truett family with this greenhouse as part of the development to showcase this open space. Next slide. We just want to talk about just details about the project, school, jobs, taxes, things of that nature. So just wanted to show that. You can read that at your leisure, but I'll just open it up to the floor and see any questions you may have, and happy to address those as we can. We do have a 3D model. If you don't mind, if we can share it around the room, is that all right? While we talk about it?
Sure.
Could we break up the meeting a little bit?
Roger, can you clarify one thing?
Sure.
Gary, out of all the buildings that you have, you're only asking for the height of four stories for one building, isn't
correct.
That?
Okay. One building, the one adjacent Daniel Drive.
All the buildings, you have one.
Correct. Thank you.
I got one.
Go ahead.
So in that height request, it's just 2.5 more feet higher than the Jamison.
Right. Per the historic zoning documents, you can be within 10% of existing historic structures, which the Truett House is in the historic overlay. Jamison Station is in the historic overlay, so they're both historic, the way you want to read it. But yeah, we are saying be within 10% of the maximum height of that building. And that diagram shows 30 inches there. It may fluctuate within that, but we are seeking within 10%.
So I think we've met and discussed this project, which we, you know, for Clay, we focused on zoning only, because it wasn't a public comment. But as I've been, I fully support this project. I think it's a great addition to unlocking, I think, the value of the factory, particularly the walkability. I think the underground parking provides for that walkability. If we reduce the number of parking spaces, I think that just further entices the type of people that want to live there aren't going to be car-heavy individuals. and so they might be more applicable to walk. So I think I really like it. I think this is a little bit different than the apartment complex we just discussed in a different part of town. I think this is unique, and we need this in this part of town. You know, as far as the 4.5 stories go, I think I'm going to defer to the Historic Zoning Commission on that. And if you can get the support of the Historic Zoning Commission, then I can support that. I think getting the support of the Historic Zoning Commission is going to be a really key part on my approval of that aspect of the project.
Thank you, Nick. Just to clarify, we have gone through historic zoning for a preliminary certificate of appropriateness or a subdivision. So they've given us that nod to go forward and move ahead with our PD. So our next step would just come in with detailed buildings, everything in their purview, which is basically the frontage along Liberty Pike, a little bit of Daniels. The residential that wraps around is not in the HPL, so they're focusing on the townhomes, the two multifamily buildings, and two residential units. So,
okay,
Chair. Thank you.
Oh, go ahead, and then I'll go last.
Alderman Peterson.
Just to talk about a part that really kind of hasn't been mentioned, but in, whenever you were showing, like, slide 10, you show the, you know, the current street, Liberty Pike there. I want to say several things about Liberty Pike, but the first thing I want to say is, if you look at all those trees that they show out there and how they are in between the sidewalk and the street, we know in downtown what happens whenever you try to plant trees in just a little bit of green space. It's not going to work, first of all. Okay. The second thing, also still talking about Liberty is a street that has a great deal of traffic on it. First of all, if you think about it, in the city of Franklin, there are very few streets like Liberty that parallel another main street like 96 East there. I mean, and this one, if you think about how far Liberty goes out, it has the potential to have enormous number of people coming in this way. And a lot of people do use Liberty, well, except maybe before we've had all the stuff on Franklin Road, which is, you know, has been broken up for I don't know how long, months and months and months. But I really have a concern about your showing that Liberty now has a little median in it. And I mean, all the way, I mean, it looks pretty, but I mean, in reality, that's needed for vehicles. And as I say, it's not that people are just going to stop whenever they get here and not use Liberty anymore. I mean, the people that have used that for all these many, many, many years are not going to, I mean, as I say, as pretty as all this looks, I think the reality is that it's not going to be able to be worked that way. And as I say, that's just my main thing that I want to say right now. There are a lot of other aspects of it, and I have actually already had some people speak to me who live, I guess, between here and Old Liberty, because they have a lot of problems with stormwater or drainage and everything.
Just plain old flooding, Ann.
It's flooding.
That's right.
And
flooding.
I'll touch on that in a minute. So.
Yeah. And so even actually one person who, whenever they came in, built their house above what was required if you were building in the floodplain, you know, if you had to elevate it a certain amount and everything, but still are finding now, even without something like this being built, they're having a great deal of trouble with drainage and stormwater coming through this. So, you know, the idea sounds really neat in some respects, but I think reality needs to come in too. It's just not just like this was going to be, you know, set down in the middle of something where people are not already using this area. I will ask one question. Whenever you're talking about the height and everything, what about the, and I hadn't even gone back, I got there to look at it. How tall are the apartments that are, you know?
Jameson Station?
Not Jameson Station. Across the street from it, you know.
Everly.
Yes, that sounds right.
Everly. Across the railroad tracks.
Across the railroad tracks.
Those are three-story.
And so how are they, just three-story or what?
Yeah.
Three-story.
Yeah, we worked on that project.
There are a lot more things I could say, but I just wanted to make one point.
Real quick.
Thank you.
I'll try to keep it. I won't touch on, because I agree with him. I'll let you.
Okay.
But I will say, my question, I want to go back to what staff said. Mm-hmm. And I think that, correct me if I'm wrong, you know, about the first thing that popped out at me was the reduced parking, which I have no problem with underground. I think that can be accomplished. But I think that what staff said was that could be accomplished without actually changing it in Envision Franklin. Is that what you were saying? I want to go back to what you were saying about that.
That's correct. Part of the proposed special consideration is to allow for parking reductions to be considered when underground parking is provided.
Right.
But Envision Franklin doesn't speak towards parking requirements as far as how many spaces are needed,
right.
Which is why staff just believes that this portion isn't necessary.
So what I was going to say to you is because you guys may be the only game in town that does it. So I think we can address that.
Yeah.
For this project, rather than just change it for everybody, because you guys have been very innovative, and the project looks great. I think there are some other concerns that we're touch on,
That's right.
I think that we could probably, rather than change everything for that, you guys may be the only game in town that does. I think we can address that reduced parking just on your project, is what I feel.
Yeah, we can work through that. We just know that the Franklin parking demand for multifamily is very high.
Right.
And we were always shunned when we came back for a parking reduction. We just don't want that to happen.
Right. But I will be concerned about traffic. I own some property that's beyond here.
Right.
Traffic in this area and with the nice median and all that, let me tell you, it is very high. And it has reduced some because of the work on Franklin Road, but that's a concern.
I just don't want you to be alarmed when we ask for that reduction. Like, well, why didn't you ask that?
Since we're talking about parking, I'll go ahead and jump in here because your southernmost parcel here touches the shaded zone X in the flood maps.
Correct.
Part of that property is in the shaded zone X, which is a 500-year flood zone.
Yes.
And it's just a short distance to where
you get
to.
Yeah, it's on that little pipe stem coming up.
To indeed the 100-year flood.
That's right.
The special flood hazard area as regulated by FEMA. So, and I'm not sure exactly how engineering would regulate, because you're talking about two layers of below grade parking on a parcel that's adjacent to the 100-year floodplain.
Yeah, yeah. Very good point.
In Nashville, that would be denied because it's, if you're adjacent to, you're regulated as though you're in. And so I don't know, you'd have to look at
elevation.
Where those profiles cut across Liberty Creek, because there are brand new houses on Liberty Creek that had 3 feet of water in their garages in March of last year, or 2 years ago.
Yep.
And so to suggest that they're not in danger of any potential flooding, there are hotels in downtown Nashville that have to routinely pump out their lower levels of parking because it constantly fills with water. So, and there are also provisions in some of the FEMA guidance documents that prohibit underground parking under residential structures that are in the floodway or floodplain, floodplain. So we just need to make sure that from a city perspective that we're properly regulating that. We need to make sure from a safety perspective that if you do build two levels of underground parking, that you're not in a situation where somebody's grandmother's Porsche got, flooded by water because they weren't in town that weekend to get it out of a lower level of parking.
Don't want that.
So that's a bad place to be. And my only other concern was over just that I like what I've seen in the exhibits relative to transitioning, because I'm generally not in favor of, let's add one more floor and see if that floats. But there looks to be, reasonable transition down to the historic, to the Truland house on the, Franklin Road.
That's the driving.
So that's real important from my perspective as well. So.
Thank you, Roger. That'll be in the PD. We'll get all those details of drainage.
Commissioner Williams?
Yeah, I would just say on the penthouse, for the additional height, I would encourage you to push that back from the facade of the building as far as possible to reduce the visibility of it while you're on Liberty Pike.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we've talked about what the architect's about, just how does that offset work. Because you know, some areas may be 20 feet, some areas may be, there's like a sun deck overlooking Carlos Del Park that may be 50 feet back. Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, thank you.
Commissioner McElmore. Oh,
I like the project.
Thank
I think
you.
It's going to be a great project for the community and for the factory district. There are going to be opportunities for any lower price point affordable housing in this units that will be in, that will be rented. As far as you know, any opportunities for affordable?
We have talked rentals. About, you know, the market's going to dictate a lot of things. We've mm-hmm. talked about attainable units.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why this allowing for additional height allows us to add more units, which spreads the cost of the development to mm-hmm. allow for something at different price points.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we're asking for, market rate, attainable housing opportunities.
And that extra height will allow you.
Correct.
And is that going to be the building on the corner of Daniels and Liberty?
The two larger buildings,
the two large,
multifamily residential, a mix of 1, 2, and 3 bedrooms.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Alderman Potts?
Yes, sir. I'll be brief. I wanted to just start off on slide 4. I appreciate the fact you guys are bringing forth shared goals on trying to both preserve this area as well as improve what we experienced last week at the Franklin Envisioning Project.
Yeah.
I think that was a great,
yes.
great move, and I know that the goals that you speak to here are great. I appreciate the fact that as I'm getting to your 3 bullet points, 47% open space with underground parking, is that what you were saying?
Yes, sir.
All right.
That includes terraces, plazas, courtyards, open space, the 75-foot buffer, green or plaza, yes.
All right, and I think that's great. I am concerned, as the chair just recognized, the potential for flooding. I know that there's a lot of great technologies where hotels are able to pump that out, but you know that's a concern. I know you guys will cross yeah. off the list. I've been very adamant and outspoken about the height of structures inside the Macatcher Loop and adjacent to Roper's Knob, for example, mm-hmm. And other hillsides. In this particular case, I do like what was shared a moment ago regarding pushing back that additional height that's being asked for. If that's the case, then I think that would be an exception that I would be willing to look at as well. And I also just want to put in here, when you talk about the limited retail, having the depths across the front of the structure, I think add value to the experience
right.
as well.
Right.
So
thank
that's
you.
My feedback.
Appreciate it, Jason.
Okay, Commissioner Berger. I mean, Alderman Berger.
She's been elevated.
Commissioner.
Oh, wow. No thanks. The board models were very helpful. Thank you for those. Yeah, they really, really helped. The concern about the median and Liberty Pike and everything, you know, if I recall right, that's a pretty wide street. It's about 40 feet from right-of-way to right-of-way. And the typical lane on an arterial road, I believe, is 12 feet. So, you know, I think you got a lot of room to play with there to put, you know, it looked like a very narrow median anyway, like, you know,
yeah.
a small strip.
Yeah.
So I wasn't too worried about that. But, you know, it was brought up because I just want us to remember that's a pretty wide road. Weren't we told one time that about the water that you are required or going to retain all the water on site in
no.
your
I mean we site? Have to. I mean the issue with the site now is uninhibited water shedding down
right.
23 feet from
going
Liberty
everywhere.
To somebody's backyard.
Mm-hmm.
We have the chance to slow that down and collect it and disperse mm-hmm. it on a timely manner, catching the first inch of rainfall and then water
Ripping
quality, all those
river.
Systems that Jimmy and our team works together with. So
all right.
that's just
yeah.
part of what we have to
okay.
do.
And again, the modification standard of height is for only one of those
correct on Daniel
vast Park. Buildings
yeah.
that you've got here.
Envision Franklin says maximum 3 stories within Mac Hatcher.
But you only have one. And I do agree, you know, if you do have the extra height on that one in the back and then it's pushed up closer to Jamis Station and has a setback on the top.
That's right.
That you're never even going to see that probably.
And then the ins and outs of the building
yeah.
just help that.
Yeah.
Plus, it's not going to be a vacant site. You'll have major vegetation there.
True.
Right.
That will grow. Thanks.
Alderman Baggin.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
This is
part of a piece of a larger vision that I think we've all discussed, and in last week's meeting at the factory was helpful. This is a start. The corridor character of Liberty Pike, I will respectfully disagree with folks, because there's two lanes right now of flowing traffic on Liberty Pike, and with some of the ideas that I've seen, I still see two lanes of flowing traffic with turn lanes at the appropriate places. So I don't see a reduction if we do improve streetscape, and I think streetscape is going to be key. I think when you see Envision Franklin, our public meeting's response, the pedestrian connectivity and the streetscape along Liberty Pike is going to be key. That doesn't mean we're not going to have traffic issues to address, and so absolutely need to look at it. There's some room for expansion of the road too, even possibly. Again, I think the Envision Franklin process we're going through, I hope we keep an open mind to the streetscape of Liberty Pike. Open space of 46.5% or whatever it was, that's fantastic. Height versus design, I encourage everyone to go back and listen to Historic Zoning Commission as you contemplate the height. They did a fantastic job of reviewing that in detail and weighing the positives and negatives of the height. Very thorough. Reduced parking. I understand why staff says, you know, don't put that in there, but then staff doesn't get to hear the tenor of the board and the commission about whether or not we want to allow reduced parking. And so while, yes, it's possible that outside of this amendment, and by the way, this is just for this property. This isn't for the entire Envision Franklin. So I think there was a comment that this would apply to everyone. This would not apply to everyone. So I think it would be really, I don't know, if I was staff, I would kind of want to know what the elected folks and the commissioners were thinking regards to reduced parking. And this voting on this would provide that feedback, so then they could make those adjustments. I'd like to know how many. We don't have those details, and so we don't know, but this is just feedback. I'd like to at least have the chance to weigh in if that is something that staff's going to be considering. If we start regulating properties adjacent to the 500 floodplain, I might lose my mind. I understand. You need to follow our ordinances as written, and if we start creeping into properties outside the 500-year floodplain and talking about floodplain, we're going to have lots of issues, quite frankly. That being said, I think this needs to be well-designed, and sure. Commissioner Lindsay would look to your expertise on understanding the design and how it would affect, and I think that's what you were saying, but I certainly do not want to look into regulating in our ordinances properties adjacent to the 500-year floodplain. We would all be in a lot of properties. A lot of citizens would not like that. Street lanes, streetscape, I've talked about. I think that's it. Historic zoning meetings was very, very insightful, and I hope that you all will take their recommendations and comments and criticisms to heart.
Okay, and Mayor Moore, we'll wrap up.
I'd start out, but I like the open space. I appreciate the pictures, which are creating a vision for me about the project. I appreciate the explanation on the building height, that particularly as it transitions to Jameson Station. The project's growing on me. One thing that's not growing on me, I've seen so many projects come forward and talk about attainable and affordable. Well, if we're going to say that, let's put some teeth in it rather than just say it. If you're not going to do it, or it's not attainable, don't put it in there. I mean, the project is has a lot of great value, but I hope you can reach that goal.
Thank you, sir. Our clients are here. They're listening, so thank you.
Great. Thank you very much. We got one more case.
Appreciate you.
And we're running short on time. So item number five tonight is discussion of Envision Franklin Land Use Plan Amendment, proposing a change from mixed residential design concept to neighborhood commercial design concept for the properties located at 4315 South Carruthers Road and 3453, 3465, 3485 and 3513 to 3515 Carruthers Parkway. Staff presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Throughout 2022, our staff met with Mr. Dennis Carruthers, who's seated in this boardroom. There he is in the back. He knows his way around City Hall. He expressed concerns about the approved gas station that's just a parcel or two down from his home, and the new traffic light that's going in very close to his residence. So he and his neighbors located between Carruthers Parkway and I-65 are seeking to change their Envision Franklin design concept from mixed residential to neighborhood commercial. The request generally meets the plan amendment criteria, and our staff is inclined to support this request. However, our staff is seeking more, thank you, sir. Our staff is seeking more specificity for the parcel that is currently part of Lockwood Glen. It has always been slated for single family residential uses with the access shown through the neighborhood. So our staff would like to ensure any new uses for that specific parcel are compatible with the adjacent single family homes that have been constructed, and as well as the appropriate vehicular access provided. I'd also like to note that a neighborhood meeting was held on February the 7th. It was very well attended. And it was also the first time that many of the nearby residents learned about the approved gas station and other uses at 4309, and I think Greg will get into that. So that prompted many questions. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, thank you. Greg.
Hi, my name is Greg Gamble, and I have the unique opportunity tonight of representing five different property owners. I think the presentation will be pulled up here in just a moment. You're fine. That'll work. Actually, do you mind going to the next slide for me? So these properties are all at the intersection of Carruthers Parkway and South Carruthers Road. South Carruthers Road is the east-west road here. Carruthers Parkway one day will be a four-lane median divided boulevard. Four of these properties are located directly in between I-65 and Carruthers Parkway. The properties in Envision Franklin are currently identified as mixed residential, meaning you could develop these properties with single-family homes, townhomes, duplexes, or multiplex four-unit condo buildings. The property owners, now that the property just to the immediate south of them has an approved site plan for neighborhood commercial uses, would like for you to consider neighborhood commercial uses for their property. If you'll go to the next slide there. Carruthers Parkway is an arterial road, and Carruthers Road is a collector road. This intersection will be signalized, and that signalization is a part of the approved neighborhood commercial site plan for the property that is identified as 7541 on this map. Okay. So again, today, these properties are currently not only in Envision Franklin as mixed residential, they're also zoned mixed residential. The property that is just to the south of these is currently zoned neighborhood commercial. What we're requesting is your consideration of that Envision Franklin plan amendment for these two areas. On the bottom right corner there of South Carruthers Road and Carruthers Parkway is a property that is approximately 3.5 acres in size. It has a stream channel that runs along its southern boundary that has 60-foot buffers from top of bank, so 120 foot of preservation area between this property and the homes in Lockwood Glen just to the immediate south. This request will actually be a separate discussion at the Planning Commission meeting. So one discussion will be the four properties that are between I-65 and Carruthers Parkway. And then there will be a second consideration for this property that is a part of the Lockwood Glen PUD. If you'll go forward to the third slide after these two, yeah, keep going forward there. We're required as a part of the Envision Franklin Plan Amendment request to show you a conceptual plan, what this might look like. If you'll keep going, one more. This is made up. We don't exactly know how this property would be developed, but what I want to point out is that the access to this site directly across from Falcon Creek Subdivision would align, and then all of these properties would be required to have internal connectivity from internal drive to internal drive or internal parking lot to internal parking lot. All of buildings in neighborhood commercial are required to be brought up within 5 to 30 feet, I believe, in neighborhood commercial, to the right-of-way line. So they're required to create a pedestrian streetscape along Carruthers Parkway. This plan starts to achieve those items that are required in the development plan for neighborhood commercial. The uses that are shown on here include uses that are identified in Envision Franklin. They aren't word for word from your zoning ordinance. So I've provided to you a list here in this 8.5 by 11 packet of the zoning ordinance and the uses that are supported in neighborhood commercial. And these uses, if these properties are rezoned to neighborhood commercial, could include commercial recreation, clinics, education facilities, daycares, indoor animal services, personal services, restaurants, retail, and the like. One special consideration that the owners have agreed to is that for the properties located between I-65 and Carruthers Parkway, north of South Carruthers Road, and the southeast corner of Carruthers Parkway and South Carruthers Road, uses will be restricted to include the following. Number one, on this first page, I'm reading from this very first page here. Number one, live-work units and multifamily residential may be appropriate as a part of a master plan if located on the upper floors of non-residential buildings. That's a special consideration that's already in neighborhood commercial policy in Envision Franklin. So that's already in there. Now, the only way you can get residential on top of commercial is to submit a PUD. You can't do that under the neighborhood commercial base zone. So if somebody comes in and asks for a rezoning of their property to neighborhood commercial, and it does not include the PUD for multifamily on top, then they won't be able to get that. They have to do that through a PUD. The second, community gardens, commercial recreation, pasture parks, open space, charitable, fraternal, and social organizations, clinics, education facility, essential services, daycare centers, indoor animal services, office, personal services, retail, restaurants, retail, and office uses, and uses with drive-through facilities would be the only uses in the zoning ordinance that would be supported in this policy change. In other words, they're excluding gas stations and funeral homes, which would otherwise be acceptable in a neighborhood commercial district, from these properties. And so that's an overlay that they want to add as a special consideration as a part of the policy. Now, we've not discussed this with staff, so the wording of this and the wording of the language is probably going to be refined before it comes to the Planning Commission. We certainly want to work with Andrew and Eric and make sure that we get the wording right and it's done in the way that they will support. But I did want you to see the intent tonight of what we're trying to achieve through this Envision Franklin plan amendment. So on the next couple of pages, we have some illustrations of some building types that fit the commercial mixed-use building type. And this is kind of what we think or would imagine or envision would be a part of these properties as they're brought up to the street on Carruthers Parkway. Yeah, you can stop there on the architectural character. You're fine. I did include as a part of the package tonight the approved plan that's just north of the lake. If you have any questions about that, I'm happy to talk to you, answer any questions that you may have on that as well. But this Envision Franklin policy request is primarily for those properties that are in between the future four-lane median divided Carruthers Parkway and I-65 and the corner of Carruthers Road and Carruthers Parkway.
Comments? comments, questions?
I got a quick question. Did we approve a project that you brought that was residential in one of these properties before?
Yes, you did. Do you mind scrolling back up to the master, the conceptual master plan? So the property that's to the very north is currently approved for 7 units in a combination of 3- and 4-story multiplex mm-hmm. buildings. There's an existing duplex on the property now, and they were talking about converting that duplex into a 3-unit building and then building a 4-unit building adjacent to it. The owners have since decided that that's not something that they want to pursue.
And actually, to jump on board with that, the vesting for that project was recently expired.
Mm-hmm.
So
that, oh, okay.
that yeah, PUD is void.
Well, I was going to suggest you might want to put the funeral home back in because the people in Falcon Creek are pretty mad about the gas station. And so we've had some, you know, I mean, I think that's a perfect example of what happens, adverse consequences of some of the things we do. And we were aware of that whenever we approved that other piece of property, that something else could go there and maybe wasn't what we wanted to go there. So I do appreciate the fact that there's some exclusions. I don't think I've seen that before. I don't know why we hadn't considered that before.
Right. Well, it's not in the zoning ordinance. That's the thing about it. In the zoning ordinance, whenever it says neighborhood commercials, those things are allowed. And so that's how that happened several years ago.
Exactly.
We kind of drew from
and actually I went back and finally they got me this information and everything. On the very first part of, I mean, this was in a consent item on the agenda, but on the very first part of that, whenever it's talking about this, it just says something like let me think what we said. It said office, some kind of commercial and something. Oh, it said office, retail, and a daycare center. I believe that's right. It did not say that the retail center was going to be something that had a gas station with it. Whenever you go on down and look at the other parts of what it said there, it does mention gas station. Mm-hmm. And actually, whenever I looked back at, there were 43 pages of stuff on the and even I didn't read the 43 pages back in whenever it was 2021 or something like that, but it's very possible that a lot of people might have just seen what it said about retail, office, and daycare there.
We're kind of drawing from the special considerations that you approved with the Shorts property. And then we were very specific about the uses that are a part of Envision Franklin for that property. So this is not unprecedented. You've done this before. You've approved special considerations that speak directly to the use.
Okay. Emily has got
a... I just wanted to clarify one procedural piece of this. So I think, you know, putting in the special consideration is definitely something that will help narrow the uses. But just keep in mind that if the property owner requests a future rezoning to neighborhood commercial, that zoning cannot be conditionally approved. So in order to implement this special consideration, the only way to do that would be through a plan district or a PD submittal. It would not be able to go to the neighborhood commercial zoning district mm-hmm. unless we amend the zoning ordinance to remove certain uses from the neighborhood commercial district. So just keep that in mind procedurally. This is still, a really good improvement, I think, on how we've gone through this particular Envision Franklin amendment discussion, and I think there's a lot of merit to putting these in here, but it might mean that in order to develop the property and limit the uses, it might have to come in as a plan district in order to narrow those uses in the zoning stage, because neighborhood commercial zoning would mm-hmm. still allow gas stations
Good
and
point.
Funeral homes
Good
unless
point.
the zoning ordinance is amended at a future date.
Well, maybe the message is being sent tonight, though, to these property owners, that if they bring that in, they would not get neighborhood commercial because it does include gas stations and all that. They would need to bring it in as a plate. So maybe that message has already been sent.
Okay. Alderman Potts, yes.
And I know Commissioner Franks had something as well. I just want to see if Mr. Gamble could also speak to on the corner lot along the triangle where it looks like there's foliage and everything, if you could explain what's right there along that line. Right there.
That's what the creek is, right?
Sure. Mm-hmm. There's a stub street right now from Lockwood Glen to the property line. To be extended as a bridge. A lot of the neighbors that are right there in Lockwood have said maybe a pedestrian connection is okay, but extending the road, they have questions about. Staff still would like to continue to add in, I think, from an engineering standpoint on that point of connection too for commercial use. Again, we're showing a hypothetical plane, but there's still a lot of discussion to be had as to how that corner could or would be developed. There is a stream there. We know that there are some environmentally sensitive areas along that stream that need to be protected. And the property is currently approved, I believe, for, where's Mark? Oh, you're here, five single-family homes. Mm-hmm. So it could be developed today as five single-family homes. We think that at this particular intersection, knowing the potential for some localized pedestrian neighborhood commercial, this could be a potential. We're going to continue to meet with Lockwood Glen Neighborhood. We're meeting with them again next week. We're going to continue to gather input and have those discussions. But I don't have an actual plan as to how it would be could be developed.
Yeah, and that's perfectly fine. It was actually the feedback that I had received from Lockwood Glen, and then also being on that neighborhood meeting, that buffer would be maintained and the preservation of that creek or that waterway right there, and anything eco-friendly that needed to be addressed. So the other part that I, and recognizing our time, I'm actually meeting this Sunday, the 26th, between 3 and 4 with Lockwood Glen HOA and possibly members of the Falcon Creek regarding this area. Right now, they have some concerns about the previously approved gas station that is going in right there. I know Alderman Berger talked about us as we not go back and revisit things as things have been passed and are already in motion, but we may hear or will hear some concerns regarding that. There's also the initial findings as far as to share with the Planning Commission is that Lockwood Glen and Falcon Creek, they recognize the need for small commercial boutique style there in that area. But they're active and they're wanting to share their concerns.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
And that's Mr. Franks.
Thank you.
Man, it sounds like I missed a community meeting at